before they even can start. Okay, let's begin. So I think this is lecture number 7, right? Here we'll be talking about multi-criterion optimization. Today I'm going to tell you very basics of how is it different from single criterion optimization, what we have looked at so far, and one or two algorithms. There are a lot more slides I have here than I'm going to cover. Because there are a few other things beyond this that I would like to talk to you about, and then we have today and tomorrow. So let's see how far we can go. First of all, there is a bit of history which I'm going to talk to you about, but there are lots of books that are available in this field. Some of them are textbooks which are used in various universities. Some of them are research monographs where multi-objective applications or multi-objective in certain areas. This one I have compiled about 4 or 5 years ago, so there are a few more now. Just to tell you that this itself is a field of research and application where lots of EMO researchers or evolutionary algorithm researchers are working. So what I'm going to talk about is what is multi-objective optimization, how you do with classically, how you solve them classically, and what are the difficulties, if any, the classical methods have, so that we need to do a evolutionary method. And then I'm going to divide the whole literature on EMO. EMO is evolutionary multi-objective optimization into two phases. One is the early methods and then the later methods. I call it non-elitist and elitist because that's how they are mostly can be classified. Then how to handle constraints and an application study, and maybe we'll follow up with some decision making at the end, okay? So let's first get to the bottom of it and see what happens when you have multiple objectives. So we are talking about a problem. I'm not sure if I skipped some slides here. May not be, okay. So basically what you have here is a set of objectives instead of one objective, and there are certain constraints, right? And the So when you have such a scenario, when there are number of objectives and one constraint or a number of constraints, the issue becomes is what solutions are important, what solutions are optimal. So there is a concept of Pareto optimality or dominance-based optimality. That's what we're going to talk about first, okay? So if you have, for example, two objectives, F1 and F2, say F1 has to be maximized and F2 has to be minimized, then we say a solution 1 dominates a solution 2 if both the conditions here I have laid out are satisfied. So x1 is not worse than x2 in any of the objectives. Okay, x1 cannot be worse if you are saying x1 dominates x2, means x1 is better than x2. And then this is the and here, and x1 has to be strictly better than x2 in at least one of the objectives. So let's try. So let's say I am considering 1 and 2, and I'm checking whether 1 is better than 2. So let's see. Now you have to go objective wise and compare 1 and 2. So 1 is better than 2 in objective 1 because we are trying to maximize. So higher values are better. So 1 has a higher value than 2. So 1 is better than 2 in objective 1. Is 1 better than 2 in objective 2? The answer is yes, because we're trying to minimize. So 1 has a smaller value. So first one gets satisfied that it's not worse than x2 in both objectives. In fact, it's better in both objectives. So second one is also getting satisfied. It's better than 2 in both objectives. So both are satisfied, so I can say 1 dominates 2. In other words, 1 is better than 2. So this could be a criteria that you can use in your tournament selection, for example, that you have 1 and 2 being compared, which is better. Now you can use this definition to say which is better. But let's do this with 3 and 5. Can we say 5 better than 3? Okay. So 5 has a better value than 3 in F1, but 5 has a worse value than 3 in F2, because you're minimizing F2. So 3 is better. So 5 is better than 3 in F1, but 3 is better than 5 in F2. So 5 cannot dominate 3 because it violates the first condition. 5 is worse than 3 in second objective. So it cannot be worse for it to be better. So 5 is not better than 3. But in usual situation, in single objective optimization, is 5 is not better than 3, then 3 is better than 5, right? Right? When you have a singleton. But here, is 3 better than 5? Again, I have to use this principle. So see, 3 has a worse value than 5 in objective F1. So 3 cannot be better than 5. So in multi-objective scenario, you have this kind of thing, that one is not better than the other, other is not better than this one. So what do you say to these? So they are equivalence class. They are in the same class. They cannot be compared and said, this is better, one of them is better. So in other words, they are called non-dominated to each other. They are not dominating each other. Dominating means the one that's dominating the other is the one is the first one is better, right? But here they are non-dominated to each other. So we use this word non-dominated very often, as we'll see. So that's what we mean, that we cannot come to a conclusion which one is better without any further information. Just from the objectives, we cannot say which is better. Okay. So given the number of objectives, whether you are minimizing, maximizing, and given a set of points, we can always take a pair of them and compare and say whether one is better than the other, or other is better than this, or they are non-dominated. These are the three outcomes that you can have, right? For two dimensions, I'm putting these little yellow patches. There is a nice way you can say whether one is better than the other. Yeah?
You can say that 2 dominates 3, like that.
2 doesn't dominate 3. 3 dominates 2.
No, but we have,
when we are maximizing F1, minimizing F2, then 3 will dominate 2. Right? Yeah. So not every pair has a non-dominated situation. Some pairs will have, and some pairs you can clearly say that one dominates the other. For example, here 1 dominates 2, 3 dominates 1, but 3 doesn't dominate 5. 5 doesn't dominate 3.
Yeah, no, we have F1 you are maximizing, then F2 minimizing.
Right.
But if suppose F2 we are minimizing first, then maximizing.
Sorry? Suppose what?
F2 is minimizing, F2 is maximizing, then we can.
Oh, then it's a different problem. Yeah, then it's a different problem. Then something else will dominate. I mean, then all the conclusions you are making here is going to be different.
But in that case, we can say 2 dominates 3.
Yeah. If you swap it, that this one to be maximized, this one to be minimized, then 2 dominates 3. But you have completely changed the problem when you say that. Like, first time you said minimize cost and maximize efficiency. Now you're saying maximize cost and minimize efficiency. So you are not interested in such a solution, right? That you want a very high cost and very low efficiency design. You don't want those. So certain things do not make sense to do. Only one way it makes sense. So your problem gets fixed as soon as you have decided whether to maximize or minimize objectives, right? And then all these things are valid. Once this is given, then you're saying, given 2 points, whether one dominates the other or not. That's what we're talking about, right? Okay. So another way to do in 2D only is to put a paper. So this yellow one can be a A4 size paper. And if you're maximizing F1, minimizing F2, you take the top left corner of it and put into the point. For example, I put it on 1 and I laid a paper out, and this paper goes to infinity here and minus infinity there. So it's a huge paper. If any point comes on the paper, then this one is not, then this one gets dominated by the points that are coming on the paper. So for example, 3 dominates 1. Because 3 comes on this yellow part when you put the corner, the top left corner of that point to 1. Now you put that to 3, you see there's nothing here. That means nobody dominates 3. When you put on 5, nothing is here. So nobody dominates 5. So nobody in the population dominates 3, 5, and 6. And these 3 points in this particular population are called non-dominated points because nobody dominates them in the population. But they make it dominated if you find other solutions, if you find a solution here. There may be a solution here, which you haven't found yet. But given this population, these 3 solutions are absolutely the best. So these are the best solutions of the population because nobody dominates them. 3 dominates 1, 3 dominates 4, 5 dominates 4, 4 dominates 2. So 1, 2, and 4 are not that good as 3, 5, and 6 in the population. Yeah.
So, but still I want to understand, why are those yellow spots? Like, what are the rules?
This paper kind of thing I'm saying. This you can only do for two objective problem. You can't do it for three. So what you do is take a paper and put the top left corner on there. Any point comes here is going to dominate 6. So this is one way you can check whether 6 gets dominated by any member or not. So you see there's nothing, none of these points, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 is falling here. So nobody in the population dominates 6. But 3 comes in the paper of 1. So 3 dominates 1. So 1 cannot be in the absolutely non-dominated set, right? So this is one way for 2-dimension you can quickly do. Okay, instead of going through this definition. It's a graphical way you can do. Yeah?
Non-dominated points mean the best solutions.
Best solutions. Because they don't get dominated by any members. If x1, when you say x1 dominates x2, means x1 is better than x2, right? Another way of saying is x2 gets dominated by x1. That means x2 is bad. X2 is worse compared to x1. Okay? So given a set of population members or points, if you can identify the non-dominated set, okay, these are the best solutions. Like in this case, I said 3, 5, and 6 are the best solutions of the populations. And if you want to do elite preservation, if you want to emphasize, if you want to do a selection by which you say you want to give 2 copies to this and 1 copies to the rest or whatever, then these are the solutions you have to give to the best copies because they are best solutions of the population. So one of the ways to say what are the Pareto optimal solutions of the whole search space or the whole problem, if you consider all points in the search space, which is may not be possible, so I don't ever recommend you to use this method, but if you can consider all population, all search points, all feasible points of your search space, and find out which are non-dominated, they are Pareto optimal. Okay? So if you are interested in the optimal set, the Pareto optimal set, then you have to consider all points of the search space and find out the non-dominated set. That means nobody dominates those points. They are Pareto optimal. So it's easier to visualize that way, but there are better definitions of Pareto optimality. Okay, so you see that given a population, we will be in our algorithms, we will be doing this calculation of saying which are non-dominated. Now, if there are n points, you may be wondering, and m objectives, what is the complexity for me to find that set? It turns out that if there are 2 and 3 objectives you have, you could do it in order n log n way. So n is the number of points. In that order, you can choose, you can find out which are non-dominated, all of them. Sometimes we need to do non-dominated sorting. What it means is that first you find the non-dominated set. They are the best solutions of the population. Then you temporarily discount them, as if they're not there in the population. So you're left with these 3 points. Find out who are the non-dominated set now.
Out of those three.
So which are those 2? Can you tell me? 1 and 4, right? Because put the paper again on 2, you see 4 comes in, 1 comes in the shadow. So they dominate 2. So 2 cannot be in the non-dominated set. But if you put a paper here, and 3 and 5 and 6 are not there, right? So there is nobody in the shadow of 1. There is nobody in the shadow of 4. So they are again non-dominated. So this is a second level of non-domination. This is the best level or first level of non-domination. 1 and 4 are the second level of non-domination. And then you temporarily discount 1 and 4 as well as 3, 5, and 6. You're left with 2. That's the third level of non-domination. So this kind of sorting according to non-domination is called non-dominated sorting. You require order n square computation for identifying all non-dominated levels. Some algorithms require you to do it. Some algorithms don't. Some algorithms just work with the best non-dominated set, and that's it. Some algorithms require the sorting process. So that's why I'm telling you how to do it here.
Why do we need solutions that are not very good?
to discard. So you don't know how many you can select all the way, right? Obviously, the very last ones we never need. But you don't know how many you need and how many points are there on the last one, we don't know. One thing you notice is that now every level can have multiple points. It could be that all of these members are in the same front. You only have 1 non-dominated front. Or it could be that you have 1 point in the first level of non-domination, rest all are in the second level. So if you don't do all the way till the end of your population, if you don't sort any of them, all of them, then you may not be doing it correctly. So it's better. So sometimes you need to sort all of them, but as you correctly pointed out, that some of the later ones may not be needed. So I will tell you when you get to such an algorithm that where do we stop, okay? So is that clear? The bottom line here is that, like you see, that when you, so this is the set of 6 points I have got for a problem, and I could identify the non-dominated set. It looks like a front, right? I can actually join them with the line, even in 3 dimensions, 4 dimensions, I can join them with a kind of surface. That's why sometimes these points are called members of non-dominated front, because it looks like a front here. And then the problem has a Pareto-optimal front. That means there are lots of points that are Pareto-optimal. The problem already has that. We haven't gone there yet. This could be an intermediate population. So if we emphasize these points in our selection, we may be approaching these non-dominated points rather than emphasizing this. So our algorithms, that's why, are based on emphasizing the non-dominated points. So I will talk to you about one algorithm later. But yeah, question? I gave you 2 ways, right? One is the definition here.
No, that is, the points are very large.
Yeah. N is large. So there are n log n algorithms to do it. It's by comparing, pairwise comparing. Okay, so let's say there are 500 points in your population. Every one of them you computed F1, F2, all that, right? There are every solution now have number of objective values, not one. Then you use this principle, okay, to take pairwise and then say whether one can dominate. So what you do, you start with the first one, compare with second, third, fourth, all the way till the end. And you're looking for, is there anyone in my population that dominates it? So let's say you've gone up to the 10th individual, and then 10th one dominates this. You don't have to go any further, because you know if anyone dominates it, it cannot be in the non-dominated front. So you say, you put a flag on one saying, well, one cannot be non-dominated. Then move to the next one. Start again from 1 all the way to end. As soon as you find something that dominates it, it cannot be the member of the non-dominated front. But let's say you could not find any individual in the population that dominates it, then you put a flag saying this is one of the non-dominated front member. Like that you go. So you see, I'm talking about an n-square algorithm now, because everyone needs to be compared with every other, but that's a very naive algorithm. This one does very much like the binary sort kind of process, where there's more precaution is taken, you know, don't unnecessarily compare. If you have compared something before, you keep it in store. So there are fast ways of doing it. And when you have 2 and 3 objectives, you can do with n log n. When it's more than 3 objectives, then log n has a power of m minus 2. M is the number of objectives. So then you get slightly more. Every objective you add, you are increasing the complexity by log n times, which is not a big deal. Log n is not a big deal. So these are very fast methods. And this is constantly evolving. I have a PhD student now who is working on such sorting mechanisms, identifying non-dominated front and sorting the whole process. And he has managed to find one that is better than all the existing methods now. So this is a continuous process. And it's just that if you're interested in this kind of calculations, you can always think of some ways of doing it. But the bottom line is, because they're order n log n or order n square, something like that, you only notice the difference from the naive approach that I said, order n square approach, if your n goes beyond 500, 1000 or something. If you're dealing with 50, 100 population size, this difference is not much. Okay, the function evaluation computation outweighs everything. So, but still people for the algorithmic sec, they come up with new methodologies. Okay. All right, let's now pause for a while and see. If I have a search space and I was minimizing F1 and minimizing F2, I talked to you about now maximizing F1 and minimizing F2. And we saw that the Pareto front has this kind of behavior, right? This kind of structure. Actually, if this is your whole search space, then if you're maximizing F1 and minimizing F2, this becomes your Pareto front. But if you're minimizing both for the same search space, if you have to, and I already answered for his question is that it doesn't make sense to maximize cost of a product, right? You want to always minimize. So you will be doing just one of the four, but I'm showing you what happens with this example to the Pareto front. So if you're minimizing f1 min, minimizing f2, it becomes this edge of the boundary here, of the objective space here, which is Pareto optimal. Yeah, this is Pareto optimal. If this is your entire search space, this is your Pareto optimal set, this red line. Okay? If you are minimizing f1, maximizing f2, then it is this and that together. So now you see that a Pareto front can be disconnected. Need not be all continuous like here and there. If you're maximizing and maximizing, then you get this. So it's always a boundary, an edge of the feasible objective space. This is called the objective space because these are computed in F1, F2 space. Remember, we also have a decision variable space, okay, X1, X2 space. Every point from there is mapped to this objective space, okay? So this is the objective space where we are looking at all these optimality. Is that clear? So it depends on what you're doing. In most of my slides here, we will be doing minimization of F1 and minimization of F2 by default. So we will be coming closer to this, closer to the origin. So the whole space which is closer to the origin becomes your Pareto front. Okay, in this case, your paper, you have to take the top right corner to a point and see if there's anything falling on the paper. Top right corner you have to put into the point. Okay, now if you have three objectives, how will you visualize it? So there is one more objective, let's say, coming out of the paper or the screen here. Then you have a three-dimensional objective space. Now there are lots of surface, this boundary surface you have. Some patch of that surface becomes Pareto optimal. It depends on what you are doing. Are you minimizing all or any other combination? So that, that patch will move around. Is that clear? So you can then extend it to any number of objectives. You just get higher dimensional objective space, higher dimensional surface, and some patch of that surface will become Pareto optimal. Okay? But the mathematical definitions exist, and I gave you a computer algorithmic definition of how to compute the non-dominated front for a given set of points. But Pareto optimal fronts, if you want to get using those definitions, you got to have all points. But that's not feasible. So we'll talk about algorithms of getting there. So most of the algorithms, when you start, they will be starting from a random region, which could be here. And then it'll go its way towards getting to this Pareto front and show you a representative set. Okay, now there are lots of classical methods. I'm not sure whether I have opened the right file because this doesn't seem to be the one I wanted to say. It's here. Just one second. Let me just make sure that I'm in the right file. You can check it here also. So I wanted to talk about one or two classical methods. I don't see it here. No, I think it's the right file, but I maybe forgot to attach some classical method. Let me open up another file where I may have lecture. I don't know which one is it, but let's see, 6. No, this is, should be lecture 5. Okay, this one may have some of these classical methods I wanted to talk about. Okay, so let me go with this and I'll get back to this. Some of these you don't have, but I can send you through the email that you have, okay? It's also there in my book. So first let's talk about some classical methods of how we are going to solve these problems. So let's say that I have a multi-objective optimization problem where there is F1, F2, F3, there are M objectives that I have here and some constraints. First thing you do with the preference-based approaches is you use some higher level information and convert this multi-objective problem to a single objective problem. One common way of doing it is you just weight them with some weight vector that you pre-specify, okay? So you have W1 F1 plus W2 F2, so on and so forth, WM FM. So multiple objectives have become now single objective, and then you minimize that and you get a solution, there is a proof that this solution is going to be one of the Pareto optimal points. Okay? So this is any method, any method that you've talked about so far, okay, because you've converted it to a single objective problem. There are a few difficulties. One is all of them have to be minimization type before you can add them together, because you cannot add one minimization function with another maximization function, right? No, negatives will not work, because the weights you're talking, then the weights are negative. That will not work. So you have to make them all on the same sign and do it. The other thing is, if one of the objective is the order of 10 to the power 3, like you're doing costs and you're talking about 10,000, 50,000 rupees, and another one is efficiency, it has to be in the same, let's say, waste or percentage waste. So it can be maximum, let's say, 100%. So the weights, first of all, the objectives have to be normalized before you can weight them.
So instead of normalizing, if you can set the weights.
But that's difficult. That's difficult to set the weight, because weight means, weight says that, well, F1 is 2 times important to me than F1, F2, then you say this one you're going to put 2, this one you're going to put 1. So that way directly you're saying F1 is twice more important to me than 2. But then if you have to do that thing in mind, then you don't know how much to put and all that. So it's the same, but then it's better to just normalize them and then use the weights.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a question, right? So if you're minimizing, usually the way ideally should normalize is F1 minus F mean by F max minus F mean. So it's real little difficulty to know F mean, because that's what you're trying to find, the minimum, and normalization expects you to find that. So I will show you some methods of normalizing. But one simple thing you could do is take, for example, 100 to 200 to 1000 random points you create. Evaluate all objective functions, take an average of every objective function and divide by F1 by that, so that you get it down to, so if you take 1000 points, you've randomly randomly created, and then you have evaluated F for every one of them, take an average, so you know that the, if this is the cost, you know the average cost is around 10,000 rupees, so you can divide by 10,000. And similarly, the waste percentage, you can compute for all those 1,000 points, maybe average is about 75%. So you divide by 75. So then you get to a ballpark figure. So that's a rough way you can do, but there are other ways to do it as well. So we'll talk about as we go. Okay? And yeah.
Some of these weights has to be 1.
Not necessarily, but that's a good way to put the weights. Yeah. Some of them should be 1. So instead of putting 2 and 1, you can put 0.667 and 0.333. You can put it this way, but it's not a mandatory thing.
The summation of all weights should be 1.
Not necessary. Not necessary. But it's a good practice to do that. Okay? Because you see, if I put all weights summed up to be 1, and I don't, so if I put 2 and 1 here, 2 F1 plus 1 F2 versus 0.667 F1 plus 0.333 F2, is it going to change the optimal solution? No. It's just that your objective function is multiplied by 2 now, or some 3 now, multiplied by 3. So if you have x square minus 3x plus 2, if you optimize, find the x star, if you multiply it by 10, the whole function, and you optimize, you get the same result. So it doesn't matter, but if you make sure that sum is equal to 1, you are talking about an algorithm, so you could do, because this is not the only thing that you'll be doing, as I'll be talking about. So summing up all weights to 1 is a systematic way of doing it. Okay? So it's, I will recommend you do that. Yeah. Yeah, so it's always like that. When you have multiple objectives, you get one objective. Obviously you have to parameterize. There should be some parameters. So here the parameters are all weights. If you make the sum of all weights equal to 1, you have one less parameter, right? You can choose rest all, but one is then dependent on the other. But then you still have a lot of parameters. So I think you're all getting to this issue here, but let me talk about this method a bit more. So when you have the weighted sum approach, okay, let's consider two objectives. We have objective F1 and objective F2. All right? And then I'm using W1 F1 plus W2 F2. Let's say they are already normalized, so I can just use a weight which is in the span of 0 to 1. Okay. Now, as soon as you have chosen W1 and W2, if I try to plot the contour of this, this becomes a straight line, right? Because you see, this is F1, F2, this is W1, F1 plus W2, F2, in other words, 2 F1 plus F2. So, when you draw contour, you have seen this becomes a straight line. And the slope of the line is the ratio of W1 over W2. So, as soon as you have chosen W1 and W2, you have actually chosen the slope of the line. Now, when you are minimizing this summation function, you are actually dragging the line towards the origin to a point where beyond which there is no supporting points from the feasible space, right? So, that becomes your optimum, because that's how much minimum you can get this function to be. So, for this slope W1, W2, A becomes the final solution. So, and this is kind of a hand waving proof of saying that if you do this, you are always going to get a Pareto optimal point, no matter what W you choose, as long as they are positive. Some of them can be 0, but not all 0. Okay? Then you always get a Pareto optimal point. There is a proof like that, and I gave you the verbal proof of that. Okay. Now, if you want to get this point, if you want to generate a set of Pareto optimal points, what you have to do if you want to get this point? You have to change W1, W2 such that the weight becomes like that, the slope becomes like that, and then you can get this. So, just by changing W1, W2, you can start from here and all the way get there, you can generate. This method is called generating method of multi-objective optimization, generative methods. You are generating a point every time you run an optimization. It's a parameterized version, and the parameters are W's, and change W's, and you generate Pareto optimal points. So, you have to apply your single objective methods multiple times, as many times as you need a point, as many points you need, right? Is that clear? Okay. What if I have a problem with this kind of Pareto front? So, here is my feasible objective space, here is my Pareto front, I am minimizing F1, F2. With this process, can I get anything between B and C? Let's see, if I want to get this point, what would be my slope? It will be tangent there, right? So, the slope will be like this, this kind of a line. Is that the last line that you can bring it down towards the origin? Is that the last line? No, you can bring it down further, and maybe somewhere here and near D, you will have that point. So, this point you can never get by this process, because this is not the last line before you leave the feasible space. So, this will not be the outcome of your single objective optimization. Same is true with any of these points over here, but this is all, these are all Pareto optimal, but B to C will not get by this method. You can get A to B, you can get C to D, but not B to C. So, if you are using this method and this generative method, there will be a vacuum, there will be a gap in between, and you wouldn't know whether actually there is no point or that this algorithm could not find it. So, this method does not have the reverse proof, which says this method cannot guarantee finding each and every Pareto optimal point. But for a non-negative weight vector, which is not 0, the result is always a Pareto optimal point, but not every Pareto optimal point can be found by this method. So, the reverse is not true. Okay? Is that clear? So, what is the solution? So, if you are not sure that your Pareto front is not like this, you don't want to use it. If you are sure that your Pareto front is convex, so this is called a convex Pareto front, then you can use this method, it will always work. But if your method is not convex or non-convex, like here, that non-convex part you will not be able to get using this method. But there is a fix up. What is the fix up? Another method is there. Of all the objectives, you choose one of them and call it an objective function now, and rest all you make is, I make as a constraint. So, for example, I may consider in two objective scenario, F2 I want to minimize, only F2, and I am going to put a constraint on F1, saying F1 should be less than equal to epsilon 1, and I supply an epsilon 1. So, if you supply this epsilon 1, when you add this constraint, this was your original feasible space, objective space, when you apply this constraint, what happens? Which space remains feasible now? Is this part. This part is your feasible objective space now, in with the addition of this constraint. Now, we are minimizing F2, which point you are going to get? Point C, because this is not feasible anymore. So, when you minimize F2, C will be the result. So, now you can see that you can find this non-convex part using this method. All you have to do is shift this epsilon around. So your parameter here is not w, there is no w here, but epsilon. Okay? By changing epsilon, you can generate again all these points. You could do minimize f1 subject to f2 less than equal to epsilon 2. You can also do. So your epsilons are bounded here. What if you do this and your epsilon is here? Because you didn't know the range where to put your epsilon, you put epsilon here. What happens? So the whole region is still feasible, and you minimize f2, you get d. Instead of here, what if I do there or here further on the right? You still get d. Every time you do, you get d. So for all these points of epsilon, you will get the same result. So that's a drawback. Okay. How about you do epsilon here? You get no feasible point. So the complete optimization is a waste. So you need to have a good idea between this and this edge before you can find the thing. Okay. So I think the problem is with this method, there are many, many other methods, but most of them convert multiple objective to single objective by some way with some parameterization, and you fix up those parameter values, you optimize, you get a point, and then to get another point, you have to change your parameters and optimize again. So this is how it is. I think the difficulty with these methods is first is that need to run single objective optimizer many times. Okay? You are expecting problem knowledge because is it convex, is it non-convex Pareto front? These are not easy to know. And then where to put your weights, how to vary weights, because here is a problem where I have uniformly set up weights like 0, W1, 0, W1, and W2 is 1 minus W1. And then W1 I changed, you know, the steps of 0.1, 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, and W2 is always 1 minus W1. And look at the distribution of point. I get A, then this point, then this point, then I jump to this, 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 this. These are 11 points that I got. I didn't get anything here because that method will not give me the non-convex part. But also within this part, I don't get a uniform distribution. So now if you want to get a good distribution of points to see how the front may look like, you have to then do some shuffling of W's, right? Say, okay, I got 0, W, I got this, next 0.1, I got this, but there's a big gap, so let me do one in between, maybe 0.05. So all these manipulations you have to do. Well, this is with two objectives I'm talking about. If you have 10 objectives, there are 10 W's to fiddle with, okay? And that's not so easy anymore, okay? But I think the problem is that multi-objective optimization is considered as a special case of single objective. Because your multi-objective problem, somehow they convert it to single objective and solve, as if multi-objective is a special case of single objective, right? That's where I have problem with this classical philosophy. This is kind of anti-computing. Those of you who have done computer programming of any kind, you know that you write a generic code, and then if it degenerates, like for example, if I ask you, give me a code that adds n numbers and gives me the result. So how will your program structure be? You say first, how many numbers you want to add? And you expect user to give an integer. So let's say it gives 10. Then you go into a loop and you ask, what is the first number? You enter it and have a counter, which is 0 initially. Then you add the 0 with that. And that's the result till so far. Then it says, what's the next number? So then you read the number and then you add with the previous result and keep doing it. Come out of the loop and print the overall result, right? That's a generic method for adding any n numbers. Now, after you've written the code, when you ask me what is the, how many numbers you want to add, and let's say I give 1, what does it mean? You cannot add one number, right? It doesn't make sense, but that's called the degeneracy. That's a degenerate case. But your code should not hang, because there could be a scenario where somebody is giving 1, or this program is called from somewhere, and by default, it's 1. So what your code should do? Either that, but if you have to always supply something out of the code, what is the best thing that you can do? It's the same number back, right? That's the best thing you can do. You wanted me to add this one with nothing, I just give you this one back, right? So this code that I just described, you will do that, right? It will send you back. But you can write it in many different ways where your code, when I give n equal to 1, it will hang. It will just don't know what to do, and it can be just hanging. And that's not a good coding. Here, it seems to be like that, that you want to solve multiple objective problems, but you are considering that's like a special case. Ideally, when you are running an optimization algorithm, the algorithm should ask, how many objectives do you have? If you say two, more than one, two, three, whatever, it should become a multi-objective code. So, it can give you a Pareto optimal set. If you say that number is one, the code should degenerate to have a single objective optimization code. Ideally, that's how it should be in a computational point of view. But you look at any book on optimization, they spend all their chapters on single objective. At the end, there will be a multi-objective chapter or just a section. And then they will give this argument that you can convert it to a single objective and solve using all the methods we discussed so far, right? That's not the right way. I think the optimization book should be rewritten by considering this computing philosophy, where generic method is a multi-objective method. Single objective becomes a special case. Okay? So, we have suggested one method called OmniOptimizer. You can download from our website. That has that principle. All the thing we are doing for now on, NSGA2, for example, is developed for two and three objectives, but it degenerates to solve single objective. Okay? I need to go and tell you a little bit about ideal point and nadir point, because this is what is used for normalization that we are talking about. So, there are these three points that I would like to define to you. First is the ideal point. What is an ideal point? Ideal point is a point that is constructed out of minimum function values of each objectives. So, if I forget about F2, F3, F4, all that, just minimize F1, I will get a solution. Let's say that solution is X1 star. It's the first objective, that's why it's X1, it's a vector star. That's the result of minimizing only F1 and all constraints added. So, it's a single objective, I'm minimizing only F1. If I now compute at that point F2 and F1, F1 I have already computed, right? And F2, where is that point in this objective space? Can you show me? So, I have minimized F1. These are all feasible points of the two objective scenario. Now I am only minimizing F1. So, which point does it represent, that solution? This one, right? Because you see, that is having the absolute minimum value of F1. There is nothing below this point over here, nothing below here. This is the best on F1. Any other thing has a bigger value of that F1 in F1. So, when you minimize F1, you are expected to get that point. But I am not interested in F2 that much for that solution. I am interested in F1 value. Now, let's minimize F2. What point I'm going to get? Z2 star. I'm interested in its F2 value. What is that? This point. This is F2. Now, if I take F1 star and F2 star and construct a point, I will get this point Z star, right? This point usually doesn't exist. If this exists, what does it mean? That means if the shadow extends all the way to cover Z, what does it mean? The other way around. They are correlated. That means if you optimize F1, you optimized F2. So they are not conflicting. They are not conflicting. Here, because there are two different solutions in this multi-objective conflicting scenario, there are two different solutions. When you minimize F1, minimize cost, you get one kind of design. You minimize waste, you get another design. That's why there are two different F1, F2, there are two different places here, right? That gives you a trade-off. But if both of them are the same, then there is no conflict in them. It's not a multi-objective problem. You could have just taken any one of them and optimized, and you have obtained the result for the other. So, usually, Z doesn't exist, Z star doesn't exist. You agree? And this point is called an ideal point. This is an ideal point we are always trying to find, but it doesn't exist in most points. But that's the point we call as an ideal point. There is another point that's often we use, it's called utopian point, which is have slightly smaller values for F1 star and F2 star. This could be an epsilon, you can choose 0.1% of the values or something down below. That's called a utopian point. We use that for normalization purposes. But in our emo studies, we don't usually use this. Classical people have to use this quite a bit. So it's not that important to us. Let's move to the next important point, which is nadir point. It's just the opposite of the ideal point, but the definition is slightly different. Definition says it's the worst objective vector of all Pareto optimal points. So, I've got all of these Pareto optimal points. Find out which is the worst F1 for all Pareto optimal point, not the entire search space. The entire search space worst of F1 is which point? This point here, because there is nothing beyond that in F1. That's the worst point. And which is the worst point on F2? That point. When I'm minimizing, the maximum is the worst. So, the combination of these two gives me the worst point. That's not what you are talking about as nadir point. Nadir point is the worst of the Pareto optimal set. So, which is the worst F1 point of the Pareto optimal set? This one or this one? This one, right? This one is the worst F1 value for all Pareto optimal points. And this is the worst F2 value of all Pareto optimal points. Is that clear? If you take all Pareto optimal, which is this line, this one has the highest F2, which is the worst, and this one has the highest F1, which is the worst. And that combination gives me what is known as a nadir point. So, how will you find the nadir point? Can you think of a way to find the nadir point? Ideal point, I told you. How to find ideal point? You minimize each one of the objectives independently, and each of the optimal objective values you put together as a vector, and you get the ideal point. How do you get the nadir point? Okay, so at that point, at the minimum of F1, you compute the F2, and the minimum of F2, you compute the F1 and combine and get the nadir point. For two objectives, that works. But will it work in three objectives, four objectives? No. In fact, this is another open research question, is how to find the nadir point in more than two objective problems. There is no agreement yet. There is no good algorithm yet. So, if you're thinking of a good topic, this is a good one to work on. It will have a lot of geometry issues, optimization issues, to come up with a good algorithm.
So, why can't detection be used in the high dimensions?
I need more pictures, but you can try it at home. You can see, but I'll see if I have some pictures, because I need to draw a picture. It's because it's not, doesn't get obvious when you minimize this. Usually there are more points. When you minimize F1, there's no one point, but many points that becomes minimum for F1. Then the question comes, which one you have to choose out of it. If you choose a wrong one, you don't get the actual ideal point. So, it's a little difficult when you go to more than two objectives. So, let's say we stay with two objectives, then a normalization I could just do F1, F2 is F1 minus Zi star. So, I need Z star and Z nadir, and Z nadir minus Z star. Because now this box, if I can calculate Z nadir, an ideal point, I have a box, right? And the whole Pareto front lies within the box. So, I can normalize the whole objective function based on these box sizes. So, Fi minus the minimum divided by maximum minus the minimum. Yeah. No, there is just one point. That is the point which is just the optimum for both. So, there is no Pareto optimal point. That it's itself is a Pareto optimal point. There is no other point which is Pareto optimal. Yeah, it becomes single objective. But if you want to treat it like a multi-objective, you'll have just one point. You can still use algorithms that are multi-objective algorithms, but you'll just get one point at the end. Okay? Right. That's a good point. So in that case, what happens? Ideally, if all three are conflicting, you'll have a Pareto optimal surface, right? A three-dimensional surface. In such a situation, you will have a curve. Okay? So, we have all kinds of test problems like that. So, we then say F1 and F3 are correlated. So, there is no conflict between them. The optimum of F2, F1 gives you the optimum value of F3 for F1, F3 relationships, but there is a conflict between any one of them and F2. So, then your surface degenerates to a curve, but that's also Pareto optimal curve. Okay? So, you just reduce dimension if that happens. And in many problems I have seen from industry, if you have 10 plus objectives, easily two or three or four of them gets correlated. And you don't know beforehand that they would be correlated. Once you run it, then you see, I got only five-dimensional Pareto front, whereas I was dealing with 10 objectives. Then you realize that some of them are correlated. And on top of it, what happens? If you take some random points, you'll probably not see any correlation. But as you go towards the Pareto front, all the structures tries to show up. And then you see that, these are correlated with that, and that is correlated with this, and the dimension reduce. So we have suggested some dimensional reduction methods. As you go along, you learn which objectives are correlated, and you reduce your dimensions as you go along. So, yeah, all kinds of things are there. Okay, let's continue with this. So the classical generating methods, then, what it says is, after we parameterize, we will use a single objective method, and we find one Pareto point. And then we parameterize in a different way, and we have to start the algorithm again, and we should get another point. Now, when you parameterize this one way, and you start with the initial point, let's say you're doing a point-by-point method, and you went all the way towards the optimal point, you have to overcome local optimal point, infeasible regions, and all that, right, before you come there. This is a sketch that I have drawn here. What I'm trying to say is a lot of hurdles you have to go through before you get to the Pareto front. Now, then you got the result, then you reparameterized it and start with another initial point. All this knowledge that you had is lost, completely lost, because it's a new run now. Again, you have to learn how to overcome these local optimum, the infeasible regions, and all that. It's the same problem you're solving. It's just that it's been parameterized. So the structure inside doesn't get changed, but you have no memory of it. So one thing to say, yeah, I have to run it 10 times to get 10 points. But another way of saying is, every run is now you have to learn the same thing again and again. There is no memory. So computationally, it's a waste, right? Not only it's a waste that you have to do so many times, but also that you cannot utilize the memory. Okay. So these are some issues with the classical generating methods. Then the other way of solving it is through an evolutionary way, where if you have the same problem, instead of converting it to a single objective, what you're saying is, no, we're not going to do that. We are going to find a representative Pareto optimal set. And once I found this set, then I'm going to choose one from it. Now, if you think of, for example, a car choice problem, okay, if you have a car choice problem where cost you have to minimize, and let's say some kind of comfort you have to maximize, then what do the automakers do? You know, you go to an automaker showroom, you'll see that there are lots of cars. Their price tags are already there. These are, to me, each of these Pareto optimal solutions. Cost is one objective, so you have a smaller cost solutions, and then the when you ride it, you know how it is in the comfort, or you read in the magazine of each of these cars, you get an idea about their fuel efficiency, their comfort, their safety. Those are the opposing or conflicting objectives to cost. So that's how the automakers do, or any of the consumer products that we have do, that there are more than one solution. If you go to a departmental store, right, like, you know, big malls, you will see a kitchen mixture, for example. There are so many variants. One of them is cheap, the other one is twice the price. So you wonder, why would someone buy and spend two times the cost to buy an expensive one, right? But those are getting sold, otherwise they wouldn't have kept it, right? So people have different needs and different pocket. So there is a product for every person, right? So they cannot have it for one product for every person, so they have few. But the whole idea is that they're following this multi-objective route, okay? That they've come up with a number of solutions, and you, when you go and buy the car or buy the kitchen mixer, you are the decision maker. You are then choosing which point that I should buy, which solution or which product I should buy, right? So that's a nice way to solve multi-objective problems in a collective manner, where the users are the decision makers, okay? So you see that there are two phases in this. One is the optimization phase, where you take the problem, optimize, and go and find the number of points. The second is a decision-making phase, where once the optimum points are found, somebody has to make a decision to choose one, okay? In the classical methods, they don't do this way. They do the decision making first, right? Once you have chosen W1, W2, and all that, you've already made the decision without having any knowledge about any solution. And then you optimize. So it's just the opposite. So if I go back to that slide here, this is that one. So this is the decision making phase, and this is the optimization phase. So decision making first, optimization later, but that may not be very practical, as I said, to choose, to provide what weights you would choose. And plus, there are other issues which I'm going to talk about. But this method that we are trying to follow is you try to don't make any decision first, but you get an idea of what are alternative solutions. And those solutions can give you ideas of which one to choose. Okay, you have a question? Yeah. Yeah, but each one of them is an optimum. So I gave you the definition, right? But I think I skipped one three slides in the beginning. Somehow these are not added in your slides. But so this is that car one that I was talking to about. Cost you minimize and comfort you maximize, let's say. So you get a car that may look like this, which is the cheapest car that you can get, but you compromise on your comfort or safety. On the other hand, if you go for another solution, which is maybe 10 times more expensive, but then you get very good in comfort. So that's the trade-off. Now, let's say if anybody can come up with any car, they will fall into this blue region. This is again hypothetical, but let's say they all fall in this space. Okay? So if I am producing this car, which actually cost me so much for you to buy the car, and you get only this much comfort, and there's only some automaker is producing this car A, which costs only this much and has a better comfort, so this solution is better than this in both objectives, then nobody will buy my car, right? I have to go out of business, right? So in that sense, this point is not an optimal point. Now, can we say this point is an optimal point? I will call it an optimal point if in its vicinity or in the entire search space, I don't have any other point better than it, right? Then it's an optimal. Can you show me any other point which is better than this with respect to both objectives? In that case, I have to take a paper and now put the right bottom corner here because I'm minimizing and maximizing over here. So the paper goes here and I have no point here. Same thing I could do it on B. Same thing I could do it on C. There is no supporting points here to dominate it. So all of the points on the red line here is theoretically, each one of them is an optimum. And I give you the verbal argument of why these are optimum, because you can give me any other point from the search space, any other solution from the search space. I can always find a point from the red line which is better than that in all objectives. Unfortunately, there is no one. So if you give me one, I have to give you one. If you give me another one here, I have to give you another one here. So it's an optimal set. But two points from the optimal set are one is not better than the other with respect to all of these. So unfortunately, in this problem, there is no one optimum point. There are multiple optimal points. Like we talked about in multimodal problem yesterday, right? You have a function where there are a number of global optima. You cannot say which one is better. All are equally good. So what you can do best is find as many of them as you can and switch from one to the other. But here, there are multiple solutions, but there is an objective trade-off that we get. There we had only one function, objective function, so there is no trade-off. But here, the number of solutions come because of the trade-off in the objectives. Why? How? With respect to both objectives, B has a larger cost than A, right? B is optimum maybe for you, but A may be optimum for another person. So that's how it is. Exactly, but theoretically speaking, all of them are optimum. Because you cannot find any other point in the search space that is better than that in all objectives. Is that clear? Okay. I think I missed some key slides in the beginning that's causing all these questions, but it's good that you're asking. All right, so this is the philosophy that we follow then in evolutionary methods, that we are going to find a set of points first before making any decision, so that we have a knowledge of the range of points, and then we can make a choice of which one we need eventually, right? So if you're thinking of now only the optimization part of it, if you're focusing on the optimization part, what should be the goal of an optimization algorithm? Because there are more than one goal, more than one optimum that we have. First thing you need to do is have an algorithm that converges to the Pareto front. You can't sacrifice on that. For example, if you get a set of points that has a very good distribution, but none of them is close to the Pareto front, these are not useful to me because none of them is close to being optimum. I can give you much better points here, okay? And then if you say, okay, this set of yellow points where everybody is a Pareto optimal point, but they're only concentrated on one part, not, it doesn't represent the whole front, then this set is also not good. So we are not talking about the whole set, how good is the set. We need to have both convergence as well as a good diversity. So these black dots, the points that you have, if any algorithm is found for this problem, that's the ideal algorithm, because they have converged and they show the whole Pareto front in a nice uniformly distributed manner. Is that clear? So this distribution aspect, we didn't have to do in single objective. We are always concentrating on convergence, how close we get to the optima. Here, not only that, that's important. In addition, we also need to have my set of points, my population member should be well distributed. They should not all crowd around each other. That's where we need to use some kind of multimodal optimization as well, so that we can find multiple well separated points. Okay? All right, so that I've already talked to you about. The EMO philosophy, because it's a population approach, we are not doing one by one by one, has this advantage that when you're dealing with the population, and let's say by selection, recombination, mutation, I got something, one of the members coming closer to the Pareto front. Now this member becomes a super individual in the population, right? Once it's there, this is, as I was telling, is belongs to the first front and second, maybe second front and so on and so forth. But importantly, this has a chance to mate with other population members, because this will definitely have more than one copies. So you have more than one chances to cross over, and crossing over between this and this may create a point here. So this will bring all the solutions down very quickly. That's the parallelism that you have in a population-based methods, which we didn't have in the classical generating methods, because there is no memory. So this is a hand-waving argument again of why evolutionary methods gets so fast and get to the Pareto front compared to classical methods. Okay, there are various classical other methods. This is one which is pretty well known. I wanted to just tell you the name of it is normal constraint method. It's a generalized version of the epsilon constraint method. Now, in the epsilon constraint, your constraints are always on F1 or F2. Here, the constraints are along this line. So if you minimize F1, you get that point, minimize F2, you get that point, join them with the line, and now your constraints are always orthogonal to the line. So your epsilon will move along that line, and you say left side or top side is feasible, and then you minimize F2, and you should get this point. So you can also get the non-convex points by this method. It's a little general, so it works a little better. So what we have done is we have used this method on three different problems. One is, I'm going to show you this. This is a 30-variable problem, test problem, where the front is non-convex. So some of the weighted sum approach will not work. Weighted sum approach will only find this point and that point, the edge. There is another definition of Pareto optimal points are called weak Pareto optimal points. So all these points here have the same F1 value. This is F1 and F2, right? Same F1 value. But F2 is different. According to our definition, this point, which has the lowest F2, dominates this point, right? How? Because you see, this is same as that. So this point, if it's 1, that point, if it's 2, then you're saying 1 is equal to 2 in F1. It's not worse. 1 is not worse. It's equal. And 1 is better than 2 in F2. So 1 dominates 2. So according to our definition, these points do not exist. But there is a relaxation in the definition with a strong dominance kind of concept, where you say this one will not dominate that, as long as if one is equal, they cannot dominate. Okay, because at least in one of the objectives they're equal. Other it can be worse, but since one objective is equal, one cannot dominate the other. So there is a loose definition that exists that gives you a weak Pareto optimal front. So all these are also now weakly Pareto optimal. Yeah, always by default.
Sir, how they are then conflicting?
Because take this point and that point. Okay, this point has a smaller F1, larger F2. This point has a smaller F2, larger F1. So anything you see of this shape for minimization is a conflicting front. Ideal point is here. Ideal point doesn't exist because all the points search space is here. Okay, so they are conflicting. But these ones in practical purposes gets dominated by one. But as I said, mathematically there exists a weak Pareto optimality. And this algorithm that I just talked to you about, NCM, cannot distinguish. So it will find the weak Pareto optimal point. So when I use this for 20,000 evaluations, It actually finds all these weak, and then these points. You see how nice a distribution it gets. It's not a difficult problem, so that's why it can find all these points. Okay. Now we move to ZDT4, which has lots of local perito-optimal fronts, and here is the global perito-fronts. As you can see, there's a little line here just appearing. And there are actually 100 different fronts here, 100 local fronts where you can get stuck. And this algorithm got stuck somewhere here, around midway, after 100,000 evaluations. This is the problem with the classical methods, because it can get stuck with the local front, and we used fmincon here, so it just gets stuck over there. This is another problem where there is three objectives, f1, f2, f3. Now you have a surface. This is the perito-optimal surface. After 100,000 evaluations, this is the status of all the points. They haven't, some of them have come to the perito front, but many of them are yet to come. So if I keep running for further number of evaluations, they will eventually go. But I wanted to have a snapshot. 100,000 is too many function evaluations. I thought, let's see where we are at this point. So I will talk to you about NSGA2, one of the emo methods. When we try that on the ZDT problem, two problem, we don't get the weak points. And you see the same number of evaluations, we also get a very good distribution. Okay. This problem where we are stuck around 50, now we are on the global perito-optimal front without any change of the method, because our methods are more global than the classical methods. They don't get stuck into local fronts. And this was the surface problem, three objective problem. You see all of them come to the surface and gives you a good representative view of the surface. You can see some gaps here and there. We now have NSGA3, which is much better than this. I will show you the results of NSGA3 on this problem. Same problem, which is much better distribution. Okay, so I haven't given you the algorithm, but shown you the difference between a classical way of doing it versus an evolutionary, just to make the point home that there is an implicit parallelism that goes in a population-based method, which the classical methods cannot harness, and that's why you end up spending more evaluations, or you the same number of evaluations, you end up not reaching the front or something like that. Okay. I think I'll give you a break now for 5 minutes, and then we'll start with one of the algorithms.